next speaker, Jan Breeman, he will first talk about colonialism as racism, but maybe you already saw on the workshop that there is a workshop by him, but that is unfortunately cancelled. It's not feeling too well today, so we're very happy that he still is able to come. So after his first talk on colonialism as racism, he will add a short presentation about their time. Do you want to stand here or prefer to sit?
Would you allow me to sit down?
Yes, of course.
Presentation starts with a quote which should be on the blackboard, man. The first quote is what I would focus on for the moment. The most important colonial statemaker the Netherlands has ever had was J.C. Bout. J.C. Bout, who made his career in the early 20th century, in the 19th century already, when he became a civil servant in the ministry in the Netherlands, which handled colonial affairs. And he rose in the ranks of that department. And he was the successor to Johannes van den Bosch, when he stepped down as the founding father of the cultivation system. He was succeeded by Bout, who came from The Hague and said he was willing to become governor general to consolidate the cultivation system, which he did, and with increasing profits for the Dutch treasury. Having served his stint in the Netherlands Indies, he came back to the Netherlands as Minister of Colonial Affairs. And that he was again for a couple of years. He stepped down as Minister of Colonial Affairs in 1848, when a major political turnaround took place, a major political reconfiguration took place in the Netherlands. A constitutional monarchy was announced. And he stepped down together with Willem I, the King Willem I, who was a dictator, and he had ruled the colonies in collusion with the Governor General. He stepped down as Minister of Colonial Affairs, and in his memorandum of resignation, he wrote up the first quote, which I have translated from the original Dutch. That shows the out-and-out racist ideology underlying colonialism. And you have to take into account that the Netherlands was not an exception. What the Dutch did in the Netherlands Indies, the British did in many parts of the world, the French also, and the Germans as a latecomer also tried to follow in the footsteps of the colonizing nations of Europe. Basically, the right to domination over the world, which was what they acclaimed, the right to domination over the world, over peoples who were considered not to be civilized, who were considered to be backward, who were considered to be lower, of a different race. Bout, it's very interesting, he doesn't get the same, what shall I say, publicity as Kuhn, or Daendels, or Van den Bosch. But he was more important, he was more influential, laying out the tenets on which colonial domination had to be fixed, racism. And he remained active also after he had stepped down as Minister of Colonial Affairs. He became the founding father of the KITLV, the Koninklijk Instituut of Taal, Land en Volkenkunde in Leiden, in 1851. When the institute was founded with him as the founding father and also as the president of the board of trustees until 1857. And in founding the KITLV, it was not yet royal when it was started, but it became royal. He also wrote up the mission which should guide what the Institute had to do. And that is the second quote, which I invite you to read if you have not already done that. His interest to set up an institute which would collect information, intelligence on native lore and customs was not meant to be a scholarly one. It was not for scholarly reasons that the institute was set up. The designed ambit was to gather policy-relevant knowledge on the fabric of the native economy, society and culture for the sake of keeping control over the occupied domain and its inhabitants. It aimed at alienating the Indonesian people from their own history, as you have said in the interview, in alienating the Indonesian people from their own history and identity. Dutch rule should endure with the least possible friction in order to realize the highest economic profit at minimal cost. This was the mission with which the KITLV was equipped. The collection of intelligence on native life and lore had instrumental utility and was meant to yield an annual budget surplus which would flow into the coffers of the Metropolitan Treasury. Java had to remain, as Bout said it, the cork on which the Netherlands floats. It's interesting, and it has already been said, that the colonial legacy has disappeared from public discussion, as if there was no imprint left, neither in Indonesia nor in the Netherlands. I won't, in what I'm saying now, speak on the aftermath of colonialism in the Netherlands. I mainly focus on what it meant for Indonesia, their colonial legacy, but also for the Netherlands that has been important. It's very interesting if you go to the literature on the Dutch identity. What is the Dutch identity? What is the Dutch social or national identity? That is hotly debated in politics, isn't it? And there is a variety of opinions. But in that literature, the colonial legacy does not play a major role. It remains highly understated. And I refer you to an excellent book on the Dutch identity by a colleague of mine, a friend of mine also, Piet de Rooij, professor of history, modern history at Amsterdam University, who published a couple of years ago a book on the Dutch identity. The colonial relationship is not discussed at all. As has already been said in the presentation, Netherlands has never gone overseas. But while you look at the street names, and certainly in this neighborhood, it's very clear. Also think of the colonial museums, which were transformed into Third World museums. Much to my regret, I suggest that we need a colonial museum to remind us of the past, of what has happened. And we shy away from either setting up a slavery museum or a colonial museum. Next week there will be a discussion in Amsterdam on the decolonization of Belgium, the Museum of Ter Vuren. I don't know if you've been there. I've been there on a number of occasions when it was still firmly colonial, and I think it should go back to that exhibition, to that kind of exhibition, where the natives were indeed shown as inferior, as uncivilized, as backward. The pretension of equality is there, but it is denied not only in practice, but also in ideology. And attention has already been drawn to the Forum for Democracy, a new political party in the Netherlands, which regrets that the glorious past of the Netherlands, of our civilization, is not acknowledged. And its racial supremacy. It's very interesting, you know, it's not only in street names and statues and musea, which are around in the Netherlands everywhere, that we are reminded of the colonial past. The way it has left an imprint on political ideology is important. It's important to sort out where this kind of racism has its roots, has its origin. And I think that colonialism plays a major role in that. What Bout wrote in the middle of the 19th century was a racist declaration of the right to dominate. Not only, as I repeat that, not only by the Dutch, but by Europe at large. I'm working on another figure in that landscape, which articulated it in a very powerful way, Alexis de Tocqueville, a French political philosopher around the 1830s, 1840s, until the 1850s, but also a professional politician. He even became Minister of Foreign Affairs in France. And he is known in the social science literature as the man who paved the way for democracy. That is his reputation. But there are other sides to his reputation which remain in the shadow. His unadulterated racism and his preaching of the need to colonize the world outside Europe for the greater glory of the motherland. Not only to reap profits, rich profits, as the cultivation system, but also the need of colonialism to express the domination and the greater glory of the motherland. As I said, I won't elaborate on the imprint colonialism has left in Europe. But it is a powerful one, it is an important one. And we are facing that today. But what has been the aftermath of colonialism on Indonesia? That is certainly an understated question. But it is an important one. Towards the end of the 19th century, the quotes which are shown lost their validity. A new ideology of colonialism took over. The White Man's Burden by Rudyard Kipling. La vocation civilisatrice in France. And the ethische politiek, the ethical policy in the Netherlands. It was the realization that until then, colonialism had impoverished the country and the people where it was ruling. Not only in the Netherlands Indies, but also in the Netherlands Indies, as Queen Wilhelmina, after the turn of the century, declared in her annual speech. Indonesian people had become poorer under colonialism, not better off. And that gave rise, that statement, that understanding gave rise to a new colonial ideology, which was what was called in English the dual mandate. The dual mandate. Why dual? Well, the colonial profits had to continue, and even higher than they had been in the 19th century. But the native people had also to benefit from colonial rule. They had to become civilized. They had to become educated. They had to become able to produce more than they had done so far. The dual mandate, which in French is discussed as la mise en valeur, to put to value that which has no value. As I said, la vocation civilisatrice, civilizing the colonized people, educating them, showing them the road to a better future. That was the declaration of the ethical policy in the Netherlands Indies. It came to nothing. It came to nothing. It was never implemented. And it was stalled and sabotaged from within the colonial apparatus. Not only because the white elite in the colonies were dead set against it, But also the colonial policy makers, the civil servants, did not really believe that that should be the road to follow. The ethical policy was aborted. And the Netherlands Indies changed into a police state, into a regime of apartheid between brown and white. And that had to do, of course, with the emergence of the nationalist movement from the beginning of the 20th century. That was seen as a major danger to Dutch rule and had to be stopped, had to be suppressed. What could not be tolerated was the mobilization of the people by its leaders to struggle for freedom, to insist on independence. That could not be tolerated. And the Netherlands Indies turned into a police state, with the PID, the Political Intelligence Service, a department which kept under close surveillance what went on in the colony, and which resisted the organized protest which the leadership of the national movement tried to set up.
Sorry to interrupt. Do you plan to talk about Wertheim as well in this panel or later?
I think that will be done in the afternoon, but if you give me 5 minutes, yes, then I'm done. Yeah?
Please.
A police state. An apartheid regime. And we have heard examples what that meant in day-to-day life, in day-to-day encounter. Before the apartheid regime in South Africa came up, introduced by Verwoerd, the apartheid regime already existed in the Netherlands Indies. And you read about it in the writings of Wim Wertheim. And you listen to the interview which you saw videoed. The pretension was kept up that yes, we want to pave the way to a better future for the Indonesian people who are not able to do that on their own. They need Dutch coaching and guidance. The pretension was kept up. And that's why decolonization was also considered to be, as it was called in the Netherlands, a mission interrupted. Our mission to bring civilization, to bring progress, had failed because the leaders of the nationalist movement did not allow colonial rule to continue as it had done in the past. It's very interesting. Well, after decolonization came the Third World, isn't it? In which Europe and the West at large proclaimed that it would help the Third World to catch up. The mission had to be continued, because behind that promise, that pledge of development assistance, the real motivation was hidden, and that was to continue the domination of the West. I can't elaborate on that. Wim Wertheim has done that already at an early stage. He said that development aid is a form of neo-colonialism. Looking back on that important moment in time in the mid-20th century, the decolonization, it seems as if that was a natural process. It could not be abandoned. This cry for freedom, it could not be resisted in the end. So decolonization was a natural phenomenon, and the colonizing powers had to give in, to concede that yes, now another era has come. What is overlooked in the discussion on decolonization is the resistance to it from the colonizing nations. In the Netherlands, a very important moment was the launching of the National Committee on the Restoration of Territorial Integrity, de Nationale Commissie tot Herstel van de Rijkseenheid, which was set up in 1946. By a very powerful political caucus belonging to the right already then. Christian Democratic parties and the party which called themselves liberal, but which were of course conservative already then. There was even an attempt at a coup d'etat in the Netherlands in 1946. That is known, but it has been understudied in what it meant, what its backing was, and why it failed. The coup d'etat failed. It never came about. Because at the highest possible level, the monarchy, it was decided not to collaborate with it. But the lobby behind the coup d'etat...
Because we have only until 12 to have the panel discussion with the rest.
Sorry,
so
yeah.
I hope you can...
Okay. The coup d'etat failed, but the lobby behind the coup d'etat remained very powerful. And this explains why there was a turn in the encounter between the Indonesian delegates and the Dutch delegation, hardening the conditions, the negotiations of a compromise. And that led to the police actions, which have already been talked about. Indonesia was left shattered, dirt poor, devastated, destroyed in its apparatus, infrastructure, and all that. But it had to pay the cost of the war, which had been fought in the Netherlands, and in addition to what has been already told before, Goebbels brought that up already many years ago. One of the conditions of the settlement was that the Dutch wanted to be reimbursed for the cost of the war, and it was a high cost to a poor country. But that is not the only heritage that colonialism has left. The Indonesian people were not incorporated in a policy and a political frame leading towards democratization. They were never able to understand the complexities of democracy, and certainly not the complexities of the struggle for equality. So that is also the imprint of colonialism. Not only a dirt poor country and a dirt poor population, but also a gap between the rich and the poor. And that gap has never been broached. It's not only that. I did field work, anthropological field work, in the late 1980s and early 1990s in Jaffa.
Maybe
in central Jaffa.
Have this discussion with the two other speakers present. Is that okay for you?
I thought we had to 12 o'clock, isn't
no,
it?
No, but to have the discussion with the
okay,
room
yeah.
and with the rest of the speakers.
But I just wanted to say this about the heritage of the colonial army. Trained to fight a people who belong to their own race. And that, in that way, I saw, when I was doing my village research, I saw how it was still during the New Order regime, how the army behaved to the population. It was not an army of the population. It was an army turned against the population. That is also the heritage of colonialism. Thank you.